Thank you. Well, good morning to you.
Good morning.
How's your summer going?
Hot.
Fast?
Hot.
Yes, very hot. You know, this heat killed my AC. I'm glad it didn't kill me. But it certainly killed my AC. It was $7,500. I had never replaced the AC before. But I go, wow. That's how much you pay to stay cool. Well, I'm glad your summer is going well. Those of you who have been traveling and nursing something, in your life, we missed you, but it's good to see some of you back. And you know, and I know August is coming, and many will be gone in August before the school starts. And those of you who are students will be leaving us as well. And so, it is kind of, you know, happy, sad. August is kind of like that, isn't it? And so, if you're traveling in August, may you have a wonderful time away before going back to school. But I'm so happy to see you all this morning. And Patty is our worship leader this morning, and I'm thrilled to have her. And I see some new faces in the choir, and it is good to see you. And may you have a wonderful time singing this morning. Amen?
Amen.
It's all yours.
Standing, and I shall lead you in the call to worship. Welcome to worship this morning. Okay, even though it is summertime, our lives are crowded and rushed. Come into this time of peace and quiet.
We need to rest in God's word.
God's love is with you. God will give you rest and refresh your souls.
Thanks be to God for this breakaway time.
Amen. Would you please remain standing as we sing the hymn on page 546, The Church's One Foundation.
Thank you.
Lord, we gather here this morning with lives that are filled with activity and movement. We rush from one thing to another as though we are going to run out of time to accomplish everything. Help us to let go of the hectic times and the stresses and find our rest in you. Relax our spirits and refresh our souls. Remind us that there will always be things to do and places to go, but that we need the rest of spirit that you provide. Amen. Now do the prayer of confession in unison. Patient God, we wait all year for the summer months when we can rest, relax, and travel. Our schedules change from the demands of weekly living to times which are supposed to be devoted to leisure. But we have redefined leisure to mean a flurry of activities. We need some time to rest, to sit quietly, and listen to the beautiful sounds of the world. Forgive us when we are determined to crowd every moment of our lives with activity. Help us to find a quiet center with you where we can just relax and not try to get everything done as though life was some sort of a contest. Give us peace for a little while. Refresh our souls that we can truly serve you, not out of exhaustion, but out of enthusiasm, not out of compulsion, but out of joy. Be with us now in this day, for we ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. This is God's words of assurance for all of us. God's love awaits you. It has been lavished upon you as a gentle summer rain, refreshing your souls, opening your hearts, healing your wounds. Rest in God's eternal love. Amen. I don't see any children with us. So anyhow, let's go into this moment of some joys, of sharing some joys and concerns. So anybody have one that we need to be aware of? Yes. I saw your back. Yes. Yes. Jay? Good for you. I want to thank Pastor Ben for covering this pulpit last Sunday, and for Lee covering our 8:30 service. Kay has a hand up. Speak loud and let me know. Amen. Who? So Kay is feeling a lot better, and Charlie will have a checkup consultation with a doctor tomorrow. Good. Yes, Nancy. Heart surgery. You're going to have a new heart? Oh, okay. That's going to mellow him down, right? No? Charlie had a birthday, too? Oh, boy. I'm glad you had one. Good to see you. Oh, Josephina. Well, thank you. So, Josephina is now moved to another hospital rehab place. Her jaw is fixed, but it is shot, so she cannot talk for another couple more weeks. And then hopefully she will be able to speak. I'm not sure. Right now she is very agitated. She knows something happened, but not fully. And so she's the woman who had she's a motorcyclist and had a collision with a car. And we don't know whose fault, whatever. The case is still pending because she has to speak. Does it make sense? So keep praying for her. Martin Mohler gave me a note this morning saying that Hal Mallory, do anybody remember?
Yeah.
Old members?
Yeah,
there we go. She was a choir director for a long time. He just passed away July 9th in Phoenix. So keep his wife in your prayer. Well, there is also something special to recognize this morning. I almost forgot, and it's in here, the note, that we have two students leaving us very soon, Raquel and Vincenta. Could you want to come here? I don't want to embarrass you, but I have to. So, can I have a microphone? I think a microphone is coming. So, we want to know where you're going and what are you doing. Let's start with you, Vincent.
So my name is Vincent Hurtado. I'll be returning to Humboldt State University to continue studying economics with an emphasis in energy and technology.
Wow, energy and technology.
Hi, my name is Raquel Garcia, and I'm going to Humboldt State University for the first time, and I will be going there to get my elementary education multiple subject credential.
Elementary education. Okay. So Raquel was singing in the choir, and your voice will be missed. Yeah, but whenever you're down here, let her know. I think she will probably let you sing. So we are happy for our young adults who are pursuing higher education, and we pray that they will all become a very productive citizens of this country. Amen?
Amen.
Well, thank you. So how about we pray for these two and all the other concerns that was brought to us? I did walk in with a LA Times with me to just remind all of us what's going on in Nicaragua. I'm sure you all are happy that LeBron James is coming to Lakers, but you know. Okay, some Lakers are clapping, that's good. But there are a lot of things going on in Nicaragua, and we need to keep them in our prayer. And sometimes these kinds of negative uprising will directly affect on people fleeing the country, and they might end up, you know, at the border and here and struggle here. So you know, there's a lot of things, repercussions that we need to think about, and so we need to pray for our neighbors. Does it make sense? We need to pray for our neighbors. Okay, should we pray? Let's pray. Dear God, through the works of the Holy Spirit, calm our hearts and our mind so that we can fully be present here in worship, listening to that voice of the Holy Spirit deep down in our guts, whispering our name, healing our wounds, bringing peace to our hearts. Thank you for those that came yearning to worship you this morning. May they be blessed. We pray for those who have medical challenges, surgeries that await, anxiety that builds. Lord, I just pray that you will calm John and Nancy and Kay and Charlie. Just be with them, Lord. Pray for Hal's family, that even in death, they will find peace because of you. Dear God, we pray for your blessings to go with Raquel and Vincent as they pursue their education, their future together at Humboldt University. Keep them safe in your care. Give them wisdom and knowledge to comprehend what they're studying so that they will be blessings wherever they go, whatever they do. We pray for Nicaragua. They are far away and yet very close. We pray that through your power, you will bring some sense of stability, understanding for the President Ortega, so that turmoil, death will not continue to prevail, but some deep political negotiations will come so that citizens will be safe and have their future. Lord, help us to keep them in our hearts. Would you join me in the Lord's Prayer, please? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I have a little chorus. I'm sure you all know we will sing this twice. Okay? We don't have to stand. Let's sing this. If you are able, either physically or in spirit, stand as I read the text for the day. I'm reading from Common English Bible, Feeding of the 5,000 story. When Jesus heard about John, he withdrew in a boat to a desert place by himself. When the crowds learned this, they followed him on foot from the cities. When Jesus arrived and saw a large crowd, he had compassion for them and healed those who were sick. That evening, his disciples came and said to Jesus, "This is an isolated place, and it's getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go into the villages and buy food for themselves." But Jesus said to them, "There is no need to send them away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here except 5 loaves and 2 fish. He said, "Bring them here to me." He ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. He took the 5 loaves and the 2 fish, looked up to heaven, blessed them, and broke the loaves apart and gave them to his disciples. Then the disciples gave them to the crowds. Everyone who ate until they were full. And they filled 12 baskets with the leftovers. About 5,000 men plus women and children had eaten. God's word for the people of God. Please be seated. In the course of a year here at Covina United Methodist Church, I've learned from some of you that you are global travelers. You have visited many places around the world. If you had visited Europe, beside visiting castles, you have probably visited cathedrals, right? Because those are very two important things that Europe can provide. If you go to one of those historical cathedrals that are about 1,000-year-old or whatever, what you'll see inside is statues, right? You have all kinds of statues you will find. So there is a story that Nikki Gumbel, who is the founder and author of the Alpha Bible Study course, he tells a very interesting, I would say a very cute story about explaining to a little boy about these beautiful memorials in the Anglican Church. Here it is. A pastor was taking a boy around his church, showing him memorials. Pastor said, "These are the names of those who died in the services." The boy looked at the pastor and he asked, "Did they die in the morning service or in the evening service?" A very cute story. Every Sunday morning, I try my best to come here with a message in my heart that I've been struggling all week long, and it is not done until I'm done, kind of thing. So that my sermon don't kill you. So that your time in worship becomes a moment of deep reflection, some, you know, psalmists will say a deep searching and reconnecting with God and spiritually refilled or refueled and become a nourishment for your daily walk with God. So it's more like I hope that I am imparting some knowledge so that you become, each of us become disciples of Christ. Not just Sunday worshipers. I see a difference, do you? Not just Sunday worshipers, but disciple living their faith 24/7. So, Patty and I and my daughter last Wednesday went to Ensenada to San Diego United Methodist Church for a day-long seminar on revitalization, where we heard stories about looming fear that exists in churches in general, regardless of what denomination they are. Because we all are struggling to survive. And often when you are in a survival mode, there is really no vitalness in the ministry that we are trying to develop, because we are more concerned about, you know, what's going on. So in that workshop, we learned that some non-denominational churches, storefront churches, they say seems to be doing better than mainline churches, which is not totally true. Even in our conference, our attendance are higher, our giving are higher in this general conference. But when a small church, non-denominational church, comes to a community and rents a storefront building and goes out of business in the next year or two, nobody knows. They came, they left. But if a church, a historical church like Covina United Methodist Church, who has a deep history, roots in this community, if this church went out of business, it'll be in the newspapers, it'll be in television. And therefore, everybody knows, oh, another United Methodist Church, another mainline church went out of business. See? We don't know hundreds of other church, little churches that went out of business, we don't know. But when one big one goes out, everybody knows. Does it make sense now? So often, somebody will come and will ask me, Pastor Dave, how comes that church over there is doing well, and how comes we are not doing that great? Have you pondered on that question as well? Yeah. And so if you ask your neighbor or your sons and daughters and grandchildren who go to other church, if you ask them, why is your church growing? Or what's going on in your church? Hopefully, they will tell you this. Our church is focused on discipleship and mission. Discipleship and mission. Mission, not just sending money, but mission that people are really doing something, getting their hands and feet dirty. Churches that are sending people to Rwanda for a week or two, and then they get their hands and feet dirty, and then they come to the local church, and they are so excited, they are so moved, they are so transformed, and they tell stories after stories to their congregation, and the congregation get excited, and then the congregation want to give more money, and then young people or people who are able will say, okay, I'm volunteering for next year or whatever. Does it make sense? So it's one of those kinds of things that are truly challenging existing churches to be in mission. In other words, worship is a time where we train ourselves to be better missionaries wherever we go. It's not, missionary is not simply like Rebecca, you know, who is going to Rwanda for the next 2 years. Missionary is what's happening where you're standing, and how do you want to engage with the world. So worship is not simply an hour together where we sing and read the scripture and then feel good and go home, but worship is a place where we experience the movement of God. Reverend Carolyn Moore wrote an article entitled Church is a Verb, where he talked about tabernacle in the Old Testament. Tabernacle was built, and God came to dwell in the tabernacle in the form of a cloud and fire. Lord told them, when the cloud moves, you move. That means when you are in worship, when God is moving in the cloud, you move along. Tabernacle is not meant to be a permanent structure. Tabernacle moved along with people. So, Tabernacle was not stuck in history, but Tabernacle moved with people. If church is designed to move, then it is more verb than noun, she says. Noun is sit. You come to church and you sit. Verb is when you come, you sit, and then you go and live your faith. And she says, a noun is something I come and I sit in. A verb is not a monument, but a movement. Church is noun says, I go to church. Church as a verb says, I am the church. Are you a noun or a verb? Noun says someone is supposed to provide the program and I'm supposed to come to them. Verb says, I am a functioning part of a body together with a whole lot of others and a partner in shaping my own spiritual growth. Are you a noun or a verb? Those answers will determine how missional we are as a church. Let me bring you to the text for today. All four Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, told this story about feeding 5,000. But only John says that the person who had 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish was a boy. Was a boy. It's something like a mother packing a summer camp lunch in a backpack and sending him to a day camp. Mom says, I have 5 sandwiches in your backpack, a couple of orange juice in your backpack. When it's lunchtime, if you see somebody without a lunch or a drink, share with them. I don't know, I'm just making up. Something like that might happen in the text. And so this boy also followed the crowd. This folk leader who told stories and performed miracles, mesmerized and transformed people's lives, as he was traveling from village to village, he was emptying out villages because people just followed the crowd, followed him. Does it make sense? And so they are at this place, and the sun is going down. It is now in the evening. And one of the disciples comes and told Jesus, or maybe reminded Jesus, hey, rabbi, you know, teacher, it's now getting evening. We have no food around here. Before it is too dark, I think you should send them away so that they can buy food and then eat, or buy food, go home and cook and eat. I think we should send them away. Jesus said, no, you feed them. Feed them with what? That's what they said. What do we feed them? And beside, Some of the translation says, beside a person's whole year salary, it requires a person's whole year salary to buy food to feed over 5,000 people. Astronomical figure. John's gospel says, Philip went around and Philip found this boy with some, you know, 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. The boy did not hoard what his mother had given him. He did not say, I'm supposed to eat this by myself, and besides, you know, what's the point? You know, there are over thousands of people here. I have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. He could have just ignored the whole discussion and kept the food and ate by himself. But the gospel story says the boy was willing to give everything. All 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish to Philip. And once Philip said to Jesus, we have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish. What are we going to do? Jesus said, bring them to me, right? Bring them to me. Insignificant, but bring them to me. And Jesus took 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, blessed, and then broke, and gave it to his disciples and said, share with everyone sitting here. A simple story. But there is so much to learn from this very simple story. Question that I wrestle with in this text is, how much am I also willing to give? Right? How much are we willing to give to God? You and I may assume what you know, what I know, is insignificant. I know there are more brilliant people, educated people in this congregation than me. But somehow, I am the one standing before you every Sunday and sharing some stories to draw us closer to God. Insignificant. But in the hands of God, everything becomes very significant. 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish were able to feed so many. I'm also wondering, as a church, how much are we willing to give up? Things that we have done over and over again, and each year the results are less and less. But this is what we have done. This is what we know how to do, and therefore we keep doing it. Exhausted. Right? There are things like that happen. How much are we willing to give away? Farmer's Almanac says to vine grower, you need to prune the vine 90% so that you will have a fruitful harvest next year. 90%. If Covina United Methodist Church have to give up 90% of what we have been doing, what would that be? Think about that. How much are we willing to give things that we have done has been shackling us down from thinking something new, from dreaming big, right? What are those 90%? Last year, soon after I came, we had a work day. And there used to be two humongous hibiscus in the front of the church. You all know that, right? And then we chopped it 90%. I was brand new guy in town. And people were going, "Pastor Dave, who cut that thing? It looks so ugly." I said, "These are hibiscus. It'll grow. And look, that's what we have right now in the front of the church." Now, there has been several other pruning done in this campus. I know Charlie and Les and several others in the hot sun pruned our roses. And guess how it looks now? There, that's our rose garden. But I took that a while ago, before last week. Right now, if you go after church, there's probably no blooms. Okay. Les is sitting here somewhere. Les, are you here? Les is up there. He's been working hard on our court. See that? He's been pruning. He's a master pruner. And he pruned some other plants in the courtyard. And look, that's another hibiscus plant he pruned. And someday, that will bloom as well. And so the question for all of us, it's not just the church, but even in our own lives, how much are we willing to give? You might say, "I only have 5 loaves and 2 fish. This is all I have. I'm going to eat that tonight, and I have to eat tomorrow morning as well. I just want to keep it." Or are we willing to say, "I'm willing to give this up because God will provide me for tomorrow"? Are we willing to trust God to supply our needs for tomorrow? Faith is about being missional. If we are not missional, then we will continue to lose our steam and go out of business. That's what we see. For those of you who came out of the Presbyterian Church and now have become wonderful people in the life of this church, you will probably remember this particular person whom I have admired a lot, Reverend William Sloan Coffin. He was a prophetic Presbyterian pastor, and this is what he said. "Most church boats don't like to be rocked. They prefer to lie at anchor rather than go places in stormy seas." Does it make sense? I think it makes sense. I think we, all of us, because we don't want to disappoint somebody who is sitting next to you, we play safe. And when we play safe, we are not living God's vision for our church and for ourselves. Does it make sense? And so, Dr. Owen, whom we met last Wednesday, said these words: "Faith cannot be passive. It has to go forth to assault the conscience, excite the imagination. Faith fans the flames of creativity, altogether as much as it banks the fires of sin. I like that. So, what are we willing to give? Are we going to be church as a noun or church as a verb? Do we have to go to Rwanda, or can we do ministry right here in Covina as we are? I want to sing to you a song that I thought might go with this sermon. Lonely voices crying in the city. Lonely voices sounding like a child. Lonely voices come from busy people to disturb, to stop a little while. Lonely voices fill my dream. Lonely voices haunt my memory. Lonely faces looking for the sunrise, just to find another busy day. Lonely faces all around the city, men afraid but too ashamed to pray. Lonely faces do I see. Lonely faces haunt my memory. Lonely eyes, I see them in the subway, burdened by the worries of the day. Man at leisure, but they are so unhappy. Tired of foolish role they try to play. Lonely people do I see. Lonely people haunt my memory. Abundant life he came to truly give up, but so few his gift of grace receive. Lonely people live in every city, men who face a dark and lonely grave. Lonely faces do I see. Lonely voices calling out to me. Thank you. Well, it's time to give to the Lord. Let us joyfully give to God for his service.
Precious Lord, take my hand, lead me on.
All we have comes from you, O God. And therefore, as a token of our love and commitment to your church here at Covina United Methodist Church and around the world, may you receive this offering from our hearts so that they might be used to thy glory. In Jesus' name, amen. Could you be seated so that children, we can welcome children a little bit? I know I talk a little too much, but we cannot miss this little people. Come on down, little kids. Okay. Oh. Yes. Yeah, well. There are more than I thought. I thought you all were vacationing somewhere. Nice.
No. You do. Let's see, Samuel and Malia. Samuel.
Still wet.
It's a little bit wet. Thank you. You heard that? There we go. You need to be able to see. You can if you want to.
All right. We'll need volunteers. Grown-ups. Can you tell what this is? Raise your hand if you think you know what that might be. One picture, you can get a little bit closer if you need to take a look. What is it? What is, can you over there see it? Here, Samuel, move this way a little. You look, you see some footprints. Yeah, somebody said that. Nobody raised their hand, but okay. Shouting out answers, is that what we do? All right. Yeah, there's footprints there. What are the footprints on? Can you tell? Can you tell what the footprints are on? You can come on in. Let's see. What is it? Oh, do you see somebody guessing correctly? No. What is it, Maxwell? They can't tell.
An earth.
It's an earth. It's a picture of what might, you know, what the earth might look like from space. Hold it way up, Ali and Samuel. Hold it way up so they could see it. It's a tiny representation of the earth. Maybe a little bit of the Pacific Ocean and some of the west coast of our continent. Maybe it looks like Australia. Maybe some of the... Well, we got there, maybe China and Japan, some of Russia. Be careful, don't lean on that, Phoebe. It's got some wet paint on it still. But in today's story, Jesus is walking on a lake. Anybody back there remember what the name of the lake is? What is the name of the lake? Good question. It's a lake. It's called the Sea of Tiberias or the Sea of Galilee. It's the Sea of Tiberias or the Sea of Galilee. Did you know that? It's the same lake, but why does it have two names? It's crazy. We talked about California's history, and it turns out our big kids know a whole lot about California's history and why it's called California, and maybe some of the names that it had before that, and who knows what names it'll have in the future. Is it the same space? Yeah. But who gets to name it?
The people that live there.
The people that live there, or the people that are in charge, or the person that made the map, or the person that gets all the money. It's the Sea of Tiberias if you're one person, it's the Sea of Galilee to another person, but it's the same sea. One of the things that we noticed on our picture from far, far away, can you see the names of the countries on the maps? From far, far away, from space, are there any names there? No? Are there this land and people? We could have mowed a ginormous name onto some of that. Oh, she will.
Yeah.
That's right, we've seen stuff like that. We've seen people make big pictures visible from space. But yeah, there's no names there. But who is walking on the water? Phoebe, who is walking on the water?
Jesus.
Jesus is walking on the water. So whether you call it the Sea of Tiberias or the Sea of Galilee, whether we have a really impressive leader or a not so impressive leader, whether we're in one era of history or another era of history, who's walking on the water, Matthew? Jesus is walking on the water.
Oh,
that's right. Jesus is walking on the water. Who's the one that's really in charge?
See, I knew you would enjoy seeing them. So, the last song we want to sing is, maybe we should just sing one and the last. Okay? So, if you're able, can we stand as we sing this? You are God's beloved people, refreshed, restored, forgiven, and healed. Go now into this world confident in the gifts of God has given you. Go to serve God's people, bringing words of peace and hope to all whom you meet. Amen.
I think he
Check.
They say they can't hear.
Did they all jump their ears?
That's cool.
Rude.
Check.
Check.
Check.